harsh system that was essentially designed to break the black. The code is strongly linked to women and mothers and subsequently daughters who feel torn between protecting the perception of the black race as well as themselves and their daughters. The result is a continued cycle of normalized abuse. In my recent article, which will soon be published in USA Today, I discussed this code of silence and how it relates to the unaddressed sexual assault of young black females. These cases are typically terminated by the family before even making it to the police station, as many times they are exiled from household conversations and swept under the rug by black families. Now, this is a prime example of this code being put to use. It wasn't until my participation in the Urban Health Media Project that I started to realize my normal wasn't so normal after all. My research led me to the harsh reality that as a young African-American female, I have grown up in families, societies, and cultures that normalize the mistreatment, abuse, and even incest and rape of black women. It's not that my family or anyone else blatantly said it was okay, it was rather the casual and almost normalized way that they talked about how these incidents had occurred. It was the realization that many who fell victim to the code were spending their Thanksgivings and Christmases in the same rooms with the very people who had violated them before. And they were expected to act as nothing were to happen. And if the problem was brought up, they were looked at like it was their fault. And so we saw this thing of blaming the victim. I'm eternally grateful for my time at the Urban Health Media Project that allowed for these conversations about the culture to take place. As a culture, we see young women and we judge them on their clothes, their actions, their underperformance in schools, or maybe their out-of-wedlock children. What I have seen through my research is that in many cases, these are girls whose childhoods and lives were stolen. These are young people who have suffered unimaginable abuse at the hands of the very people who were placed in their lives to protect them. We live in a society, culture, and community who indirectly says to these young girls, you don't matter, and your safety is not important. And we hide these messages of hate and spite behind the code of silence. As a culture that often puts the perpetrators over the victims, I realize that if we want to change the plight of young people currently and for future generations, then we have to start by unnormalizing assault against girls and women, by increasing and enhancing self-esteem, especially with African-American girls. We can do this by demonstrating through education, laws, and by telling our stories that in fact their lives, our lives, matter. As we know, this is not just an issue in the United States. We know that this can stretch, and it does stretch as far as India. But today, we are in America, the place we call home. And this abuse and assault is happening in our house right before our eyes. It is up to us to take off those rose-colored shades and leave this mentality and negative lifestyle at the front door and rely on our foundation to guide us. Again, I'm so honored to be here today to participate in such an important discussion that I hope is the start of a continuous dialogue that encourages the valuing, accepting, and protecting the bodies and lives of women from all different races and backgrounds. Thank you. That's it.